Well, I'm very honored to be here tonight at the Chillicothe Historical Society. Thanks for having me. And the last time I did this presentation, I did one down at the Peoria Public Library downtown and a few other places. And then recently I did one for the Peoria Women's Club. Linda invited me to attend that, and that was really fun. And I had my GoPro video camera, but I forgot to click. I turned it on, but I forgot to click record. So I did this. I tried to do the best presentation I've ever done, and I slanted it toward women. And I don't know why in a minute. It was very easy to do so, because women were very revolutionary when it came to bicycles. In fact, a lot of the ladies, maybe all of them, have slacks on, and it was bicycle women who started that, because they couldn't ride bicycles with their long dresses. Get all tangled up and this and that. And even when they had a lady's bike without the crossbar going across, it was still very hard. So they started wearing what they call breeches and so forth. But so I was disappointing that I didn't get that videotaped over there. So I'm going to try to get revenge on my error and do an even better presentation today to you folks. So this is my book, Bicycle Fever, and we do have copies available for people who want them. We can see Linda, she has some copies, and this is a photo of me and the designer of the book, and over at, what was the name of the school there?
Kelly
Avenue School.
That's right.
Peoria Heights. And that's where you went?
I started school
there. Oh, okay, cool. And it just happened to have a high wheel, what they call a high wheel bicycle. When I wrote this in 1990 for Charles Ruttman of Ruttman Marketing in Peoria, Illinois. I worked there on two different occasions. And he was very into what they call the Century Wheelman, I think was the name of it, and rode, you know, 100 miles at a time and things like that. Very fanatic about bicycles. And he, in conjunction with the Peoria, with the Peoria Historical Society, Proctor Cycling Classic, which was, I think still is a race, and some other organizations in town, Ruttman Marketing, commissioned me to write this book when I was working there as a copy director. I was in charge of all their written material. And this is around 1990. When I got this assignment, the book had already been started, and quite a bit of it had been done. They wanted me to just kind of wrap it up. And it was called The Joys of Wheeling. And unfortunately, when I read the text, it was written by a former newspaper guy. I'm not bashing newspapers, but he's a newspaper guy, and he's looking for sensationalism. So his whole book was revolving around people who were in the bicycle, and then later the automobile industry, who had committed adultery or committed suicide and all these juicy things. And that's not how my mind works. I decided to change the whole orientation, scrap everything I wrote, and start from scratch. And my orientation was not going to be the unsavory details and unfortunate events of people involved in bicycles, but to take it from an evolution of bicycle technology viewpoint. And the main thesis of the book, I came up with the phrase, prove it in Peoria, because Peoria was one of the top five places in the world for bicycle manufacturing and racing. We were ahead of Boston, San Francisco, Los Angeles. There were only like New York and Peoria, and I forget the other, a couple others in the United States, and then in England and a place in France. But we were at the very leading edge in bicycle technology. The bicycle opened up great paths for people, excuse the pun, but as we were talking in the room before I got up here, it was the bicycles that caused the roads to improve, because before they were mud, or when it was dry, they were hard, bumpy, clay, dirt type roads, terrible for bicycles. It was okay if you're riding a horse or walking or in a carriage, it was kind of bumpy, but it wasn't so bad, I guess. But when it got to the bicycles, especially the first ones were these high wheel bicycles, like you see, I don't know if you see that real well, but they were high wheel. I don't know why they were designed this way, but they had a huge wheel in the front and then a little tiny wheel in the back, And then the steer, the handlebars are like a little semicircle like this, and the brakes, sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't work. So you, what you did was you took a header, they call it. What you would do is you try to get the brakes to work, and if they didn't, then you just leaped off the bike and let the bike go, and hope you didn't break a leg or an arm or your neck or something like that. Now, we think the kids are wild today, and we see them on these skateboards, and we see them in these, you know, heavy metal rock bands shaking their hair and getting tattoos and all that. The guys in the bicycles would think they were sissies today. These guys that think they're so tough with the studs and all this and tattoos. Oh, say, oh yeah, well, let's see, get on my high wheel bicycle, if you're so tough, in the middle of winter, and this is documented in my book with some photos, and get on the high wheel and go down the hill leading to the Illinois, frozen Illinois River at high speed, top speed, and then slide across the Illinois River to the other side and hope that you don't fall through a soft patch and go down into the river and see you later. These guys were tough. They did things like that. They did wild, adventurous things, and they would even ride their bicycles and take them apart and put them back together while they rode them. There is another guy, I mentioned some of these characters. I don't even understand that. I can't even begin to understand that. There is a guy named Bert Myers, and he was a highly acclaimed international bicycle racer from the Peoria area. And he was so fast that he eventually ran out of competitors and just raced against the clock. Because if he raced with other people, he'd just leave them behind. It wasn't even any fun. It was no challenge to him, so he just raced against the clock. The thing about bicycles is that, unlike motorcycles and race cars and even horses, when you see a race, a horse race, a guy on a jockey on the horse, or a guy on a motorcycle, or the jet skis, or the car, the race cars and stuff, those are all exciting. But there's one thing that the bicycle racer had over all of them, made him, in a sense, if you want to say it, superior to them. Because the bicycle racer could say, I'm the fastest man alive on a bike. And it was not the bike that was fast, it was him. The effort, the energy he put in, the human power. Not true on a bicycle, a jet ski, or all these other sports, you know. So to be called the fastest man, that would be the fastest running or riding a bicycle. Those were the two main things where you could be a fast human being. And of course, a bicycle greatly amplified human power, so it gave you incredible speed. Now, this all began around 1895, right around there, 1895, 1898, in doing research with the Peoria Historical Society and Peoria Public Library, Bradley University, and some other and local people. They were just into history and bicycles and so forth. Sometimes it was hard to get exact dates for things, hard to find photos. There was a famous racetrack in what's called the Averyville area, where Komatsu Dresser, that area there. That's where an international bicycle racing track was. But there, in my book, I have a couple photos of it, but they're kind of crinkled and kind of hard, not real easy to see, not as sharp and clear and high resolution like we have today. But you still can see it. And even though it's a little fuzzy, but you can see it. And you can see the guys lined up getting ready to race, but there's very few photos going back that far. And sometimes the spelling of names varies. So it was a lot more research work than I thought it would be when I revamped this whole book, just started from scratch and wrote my own take on the topic. The strangest thing to me was that human beings, and I've never gotten a good answer, I think my wife supplied a good answer to this, but I've talked to professors at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, a buddy of mine is a professor out there, and other people involved in science and so forth and technology, and they've never been able to come up with a good answer to my question, why for thousands and thousands of years, human being, as far as we know, unless there may have been an Atlantis that had UFOs and you know, lasers and stuff, I think that may be possible, but putting that aside, as far as we know, and can really document with the consensus in scientific communities, the human beings walked, or they rode horses, or they had chariots and wagons and things like that for, you know, thousands of years. And it was only until like around 1895, somewhere around there, 1880s and then the 90s, where bicycles started to evolve. And I have to say started to evolve, because I think a lot of people think that somebody just invented the bicycle that we know now and it's kind of stayed the same. Of course, we know about the high wheel, and we've talked about that a little bit. But there were some very strange contraptions. Here's a lady on one. Before we had the bicycle that we now know of, they had things that looked like spiders from Mars and gyroscopes and all kinds of just bizarre things. Here's a guy in between two wheels. I think this book is cracking. They're falling apart, getting old, like me. But here's a guy in between two wheels, and here's a guy inside a wheel, and here's a guy on a horse that's got wheels. He just shoved it and fell over when you were done riding. All kinds of just bizarre stuff that was going on as they were trying to figure out a way to make something with wheels that a human could ride. And I just don't understand why it took so long just to put some gears and wheels and things together for a bicycle. You think that that would have been invented 1,000 or more years ago, but it just the way it worked. And then at the second half of my query was, okay, so we finally figured out how to put together a bicycle, which seems so simple and obvious now. But then all of a sudden, after the bicycle, a few years later came the motorcycle. A few years later, the car. A few years later, the airplane. A few years later, then well, suddenly it keeps going and going. It's just like an explosion of technology. Next thing you know, we got Hubble telescopes and probes going to Pluto and things entering the sun and all these things that are moving and traveling through space and time. But it's just like an explosion of technology. And I've asked professors in technical institutes and so forth what they thought, and they just weren't sure. Of course, some people think that, you know, UFOs crashed, we got the technology for lasers and computers and chips and things from UFOs. Well, that makes about as much sense as any other explanation, because, you know, I don't necessarily believe in UFOs, but I'm not saying they don't exist. And where did the technology come from then? And my wife, she came up with the idea, well, I think it was democracy, freedom of thought, no longer being forced by governments or religious institutions to think a certain way and be killed or imprisoned if you had a different independent thought. So I think that probably had a lot to do with it, the United States and democracy and getting freedom of thought, freedom of thinking, and freedom of every kind of expression, religious expression, artistic, technological, literary, musical, and so forth. I think that's a pretty good explanation of it. But as far as we know, this is the evolution of the bicycle. That it just kind of came out of nowhere from some very primitive beginnings. The high wheel bicycle was the first popular and mass produced bicycle, and then what they called the safety bicycle, which is what we know today. I'm glad you mentioned that term, because very few people, I think, know that term. And this is what we have today, pretty much, is the safety bicycle, as we now know it. And there are very expensive $8,000 and $20,000 bicycles out there now. There's all kinds of technology. There's, I forget the name of it, but there's a certain type of bicycle. We can't think of the technical name right offhand, but it is for people who have back problems or handicapped.
Recumbent, yes.
And I've seen some of those go down the street, and somebody's like almost lying down, and that's probably what I need. I broke my back twice. So before you ask, do you have a bicycle, Grace? I don't. I do, I'm looking at these motorized bicycles. And I saw a guy on a scooter at McDonald's a few days ago. I was meeting a buddy of mine. And while I was waiting for him at McDonald's on University in Peoria, a guy came up on a really cool looking scooter. And I'm kind of sociable, so I said, hey, that's pretty neat, you know? And I said, how much did that cost? He didn't tell me at first, and I don't know if he thought I was a thief or something, but he started talking, and I started talking about bicycles and things like that, and I said, what about these motorized bicycles with little engines on them and stuff? And he started talking about how, lot of these guys are get a lot of DUIs, and they can't drive a car anymore. I don't think that's true for all of them, but his opinion, his viewpoint was maybe he's kind of prejudiced because he's got the scooter, and that's for the serious guys, you know, and these motorized bicycles. But it's funny how people have their little orientations and stuff. But he's a nice chap, and I talked to him, and he said that, yeah, a lot of them, they lost their license. And he said that the bad thing about those is sometimes they're set for a certain cc, certain size of engine or motor, and they'll get bigger ones, like 100. It's supposed to, I think the legal limit is something like 50 c,
49,
50, yeah, something like that. And they'll get like 80 or 100 or more. And the police aren't really watching that real close, and I don't know if you can even tell.
So how fast can one like that go?
He said something like 30, 40 miles an hour. Oh. Something like that on just the motorized bicycles. I'm not sure. But
well, if they get too drunk and drive that.
Yeah.
They may not be around though.
Yeah, really.
Themselves.
Back in my younger days, I'll tell you this, I'll confess a sin, a guilt. Maybe I'll have closure. I was drinking with some buddies, and we were drinking pretty hard beer. And then I had to go home, and I had a bicycle. I was going to go to the Kroger grocery store and get some groceries. So I got some groceries, and I had like two big bags of groceries, and I was holding them on my hands and steering my bicycle going across the street. And I was, let's just say it, I'm drunk. And as I was trying to get across the street, I started kind of swaying a bit, the bags of groceries falling, getting all lopsided, not a good balance and stuff. And all of a sudden I hear, and all these cars honking their horn and screeching and stuff. And there goes cop car. And he's looking at all this, and I get across the street, and he comes up to me, and he writes me a ticket. And he said, you know, you shouldn't be doing this. If you're, you know, have too much to drink, you shouldn't be driving a car or riding the bicycle, especially with all these groceries and stuff. And some of the kids in the neighborhood were flocking around, like, what do you do? What do you do? Why is a cop stopping a guy on a bicycle? What did he do? So it was funny, but I never again did anything like that. But it was a weird little incident. But yeah, I grew up. But this whole topic of bicycle, the evolution of the technology is amazing. And now I want to get into the people a little bit. I mentioned to you Bert Myers, the guy that ran out of people that he could race and just race against the clock. There was a guy named Stephen Tripp. And a lot of these people, their last names, they have streets named after them now and other things in Peoria. Stephen Tripp, he's one of the guys that rode the bicycle across the frozen Illinois River at breakneck speed. And just thinking about that frightens me, and I'm a pretty tough guy. I'm not doing that. I'm not walking under anything across a frozen river. There was a guy named Eugene Brown, who was a poet cyclist, and he rode around downtown Peoria on a 13-foot freak bicycle, and way up in the air. And I don't know how the pedals and all that work. There's a photo of it in the book. There's also Charles Duryea, a bicycle inventor and investor who went on to produce one of the world's first gasoline-powered automobiles, the Duryea. So the unfortunate thing is Peoria was so far ahead of its time, really, compared to the rest of the nation outside of a couple other cities, that when people came in to Peoria from St. Louis or Boston, San Francisco, a place like that, they were like shocked seeing these bicycles whizzing around. They were never even, a lot of them didn't even know what they were or where they came from or what was going on with it. It was so spectacular that when the bicycles came out and the kids started riding them, preachers started doing sermons against bicycles. Because these kids are going we don't know where and doing we don't know what. And these bicycles are sinful, they're from the devil, and nobody should own one. So sometimes you have kind of extreme reactions to things at first. And they also, when the people rode bicycles, a lot of them were younger people, experimenting. When they rode these bicycles in the farmlands, rural communities and so forth, the farmers hated it because they scared the chickens and the horses and the cows and all that. It was a freaky, loud, clackety thing. And it was quite a spectacle to see like six or eight guys or women riding their big high-wheel bicycles over the bumpy roads and stuff out in the farmland. And they would actually put sticks, try to get sticks into the spokes, and put out broken glass and tacks and nails. And this is when they had the inflated tires. At first, they were solid rubber, which were really hard on you on the, as far as the suspension and the bumps and so forth. But they actually tried to attack and even harm the bicycle riders. We think of a guy on a bicycle now, we don't give it a second thought. We don't give it on a bicycle, you know, big deal. Back then, it was like a revolutionary, subversive, almost like anarchist type activity. And there are all kind of, like I said, sermons against them and farmers attacking them and other things. And it got so bad, and we laugh now, but it was really bad. And some people were fearful. And so they formed bicycle clubs, like we have motorcycle gangs now, but they were bicycle gangs. And they wore military type uniforms and looked intimidating. And they had medals that they wore from races they won and all kinds of rank and things like that. And they band together. Then when people saw a pack of people, men or women, or both, coming down the road in these crazy high-wheel bicycles, they had the military uniforms, they were a little more respectful, and not sure they got guns, knives too. I mean, they kind of cleared away for them. So it's funny to think about that kind of a background for something that seems so innocent now as a bicycle. There were people that did incredible tricks on bicycles, and we still see that in circuses and other things, in the Cirque du Soleil. They're doing all these acrobatics in midair and all this crazy flashy stuff. But it was really the bicycle people, again, who kind of started a lot of that, doing wild, risky, adventurous, exploratory, experimental activities on a new piece of technology. The Peoria had a bicycle club called the Peoria Bicycle Club. There was also the Lakeview Bicycle Club, the YWCA Bicycle Club for ladies, and the ladies would also sometimes have military type uniforms they would wear, have them actually designed. Linda probably could have helped them there, designing these uniforms for them, and to look, you know, authoritative and rough and stuff like that. But the women also had their clubs, and they would go off on field trips and go places on the bicycles. There were crazy stories about how some guys in the Peoria Bicycle Club were going, riding along the tracks, the railroad tracks, going through Chillicothe, coming from Chillicothe into Peoria. And at a certain point, it got really dark. And so this is the story. Now, some people think it's a legend. It's never been totally proven. But the legend is, it got so dark that they set a bonfire on the tracks, right in the middle of the tracks, a huge bonfire to stop a train so they could get on and get the rest of the way home. So just, we think kids are wild now. And but these again, were young people in their 20s, mostly in the 18, 20, 25, 30 maybe, who were willing to experiment with something like this, didn't worry about if they fall, wouldn't maybe break their hip like it might at my age. Another thing is, I don't want to ride a bicycle right now because if I broke my back twice, and if I fell, that could be kind of bad. So, but these are the kind of things that they did. And they, like we mentioned in the break room over there, they advocated for improved roads and were very, very instrumental in the paving of roads and actually lobbied for it and had organizations. The organizations were not just so they could have fun on their bicycles and be protected from people that hate bicycles, but they also they did other things, like the improved roads. And the city people and the rural people started to intermix. And people, the city guys didn't say, you hit town, you know, doofus or something. And the rural people no longer thought of the city people as corrupt and evil and all this. They started to have more understanding and more interactions. And so that helped too. People from others, you know, from another town nearby, because you're on bicycles, now it's easier to get back and forth through these rural communities and the larger cities. So that helped improve communications and diversity, toleration of other viewpoints and so forth. And so that was another nice outcome of the whole bicycle phenomenon. We also, of course, went from bicycles to motorcycles and cars and so forth. And we owe a debt of respect to the early pioneers in bicycle manufacturing, testing. One of the interesting things that I discovered too is that I've always, most of my adult life, I've been involved in marketing. My first job was at Rutland Marketing, and then later I worked at PJS Publications, a magazine division of the Peoria Journal Star, at Crafts Magazine, Shooting Times, Rotor and Wing, and Profitable Craft Merchandising, and later So News and some others. Boy, I can tell I drink some coffee. Anyway, I've always been in marketing and advertising. I went out to New York City. I worked for Garden Way. They make tillers, Troy-built tillers, and garden machinery. And I worked on Madison Avenue for Gray Advertising, and Wall Street Transcripts, and other places. But I was always involved in advertising and marketing. And it was a bicycle vendor in Peoria who came up with some innovative marketing ideas. And in his catalog from 1889, he had this paragraph that said, he came up with innovative ways to market and sell on credit these bicycles. He said, most firms will not sell a bicycle on payments at all, yet have a whole amount up front, or only in special cases, to some personal acquaintance, thus placing him apparently under lasting obligations while adding to the list price of the machine. On the contrary, we, and this was the George W. Rouse and Sons, they were a farm implement vendor and hardware retailer, and they entered the high wheel cycle business in 1879. Anyway, he said, on the contrary, we will sell on the easiest of payments without any extra charge, no financing charge, whatever, except simple interest, 8% per year. We do this as a matter of course without making our customer feel like he's being accommodated. Do not wait until you've saved up enough to pay cash for a machine. It is a slow process, saving up. And you might as well buy new on this plan and be having the use of it while you are paying for it. This is a theme that is now everywhere now, but he was one of the innovators. And so then he had some questions on that you would answer about what kind of bike you want, how you're going to use it, and they could make it to order, customize it for you. But this whole area of the bicycle racing, when people from all over the world would come to Peoria, Illinois, and coming through Chillicothe a lot of times, and dining in your fine restaurants and shopping in your stores and stuff on their way. And of course now we have Three Sister Park and summer camp, the riotous music and all that kind of stuff. But Chillicothe has benefited a lot from things that happened in Peoria, and vice versa. Peoria's benefited a lot from things that happened in Chillicothe. And but these people would come here and they would be impressed with the whole area, Peoria, Pekin, Chillicothe, East Peoria, the whole kind of larger community, and go back to their homes and so forth, and where the cities and states where they live, and bring back these interesting tales of things they saw, the wild antics of the bicycle racers and riders. I came up with this phrase, prove it in Peoria, because that was a phrase I wanted to get out into the public, kind of resurrect this whole idea of back then in the Peoria bicycle races, if you thought you were a fast bicycle racer, it was mandatory. You had to prove it in Peoria. You had to come to Peoria, which was, like I said, one of the top five centers for manufacturing and racing. You had to come to Peoria and prove it. And so the Peoria races were a very high prestige notoriety. So the women, I talked about how they, because it was hard to ride a bicycle with skirts and dresses and stuff, women started wearing slacks, what they called breeches back then. And this was, at first, it was a shocking thing. And the first lady, I've got something in here about her. I think her name was Tessie. There it is. Here she is, wearing her revolutionary breeches and riding a safety bicycle. And she did this mostly in the evening, at night, because she didn't want a lot of people seeing what she was wearing. You know, it wasn't so much that it was a lady on a bicycle, but a lady in breeches on a bicycle. So to kind of keep the gossip and hostility down, she viewed it in the late evening. So it was very fun to write this book, and I learned a lot. It was, I think it was interesting how bicycles evolved pretty quickly and then hit a couple of designs that stayed and lasted to this day. So that's about wraps it up, and at this point, if you're interested in the book, see Linda Heron. She has some copies up there. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them for you.
So the high wheel bike wasn't just to get the rider up on the horse's view so the horse wouldn't be scared, was it?
I'm not sure why. They were so, when I first wrote the book, we gave a copy to every police officer in the Peoria Police Department, and some other important people in town would get a copy of it. And I was at I think it was a Pet and Bill Moran house, actually, and Ray Becker was there, and he was smoking a big fat cigar, and I gave him a copy of I signed it in my book for him, and then they had a couple high wheel bicycles there, and they were saying, well, why don't you get up on there and ride one? You wrote the book, now you can get up there and ride one. This is before I broke my back. And I said, I don't know, because you had to kind of like jump up. There's a little step type thing, but you basically had to kind of step on them and kind of leap up on top of the bike. And I don't know, has anyone here ever ridden a high wheel bicycle at all?
You know, the one that's in the Flanagan basement, Rebecca Borland, I think that's who wrote it across the stage. No. Who's that artist, the woman artist in Peoria? Were you at that style show?
I don't know what it's
But anyway, I think it's the one in the Flanagan basement for a Peoria Historical Society style show. She wrote it across the stage, and those tires on it are not good.
Well, like I said, a lot of times the only way to stop them was to just kind of jump off of them.
I found this today in some papers that we had from 1893.
Well, that goes back even farther.
So I thought you might.
Well, I think this picture's 1894. I'm racing, isn't it?
There's a racetrack down at where Shore Acres Park currently
is. Where is it?
Yeah. It's right up there on the sort of brown lips. Right above the orange looking photo.
Yeah. That's who it was, yeah.
I know a lot of people here have great love for history and know the history of many things in technology and culture and so forth, not just in Chillicothe, but a lot of you have wider interests in the boats, the river, things like that. And it's neat because there's so many things in life that as you get older, I think you start to appreciate things a little more and the history of these things, how. Because a lot of young kids, they see things, they just think, take it for granted. You know, a cell phone or a computer, a synthesizer to make really wild electronic music is what I like to do. You can take it for granted. I've been going into the history of synthesizers, and a lot of people think that electronic music started in the 90s, and it actually started in like 1700s, where they actually had electrical instruments, mechanical instruments that were precursors to the synthesizer. I think the earliest, what's technically called a synthesizer, which is like an organ that has a lot of, sort of like an organ that has a lot of more controls and science fiction, spacey, weird sounds you can make, or beautiful sounds. But I think the first official technical synthesizer was made in about 1875. Whereas a lot of people think it'd be like 1960s with Robert Moog, or Moog. Moog, Arp, and Buchla were three of the main. Arp, Moog, Buchla were some of the major guys that invented and sold synthesizers. That's in the 60s. The first RCA, the first modern synthesizer would fill this room. It wasn't just a little synthesizer keyboard like people have now. It would actually fill this room, and there were huge cabinets and stuff. And it was called the RCA Mark II synthesizer. And it had 1,400 vacuum tubes in it, and had to have a special cooling system. And you played it by typing punched holes on a typewriter type thing into cards, and then you fed those cards into the system, and then that would generate on some kind of acetate, if I recall correctly, an acetate record. It wasn't like on burning a CD or a tape recording or something. So, but you know, I'm into synthesizers, but everything in life, if you are into something, boats or computers or farm implements or whatever it is, motorcycles, whatever, it's fun to go back into the history. You're probably already doing that, but it's really fun to go into the history. Yes?
I like bicycling, and I'm really enthusiastic of the wheelmen, and I know people in the Peoria Bicycle Club. It's an old club, right? I mean, it's
yes.
One of the oldest still enduring clubs in the country.
Mm-hmm.
In writing this book, did you bring to bear any of your historical studies on current biking trends in Peoria? Cause it seems to be growing. There's a new bike shop that just opened in March on Prospects. We have at least four bike shops in this area. And that, for a population like this, that's pretty robust.
Yes, it is. It's like
research. Any comments on current?
Well, I wrote this book, in 1990, and I have stayed up to some degree on the bicycle trends in Peoria. In fact, I took my synthesizers to a place on Main Street in Peoria called Renaissance Park Community Garden, and I did an outdoor performance. I think one of my best, and it was right next door to Bike Peoria Co-op, where they fix bikes and sell bikes and stuff like that. And I was so excited. I really loved my performance, and a lot of people, you know, enjoyed it and so forth. Got a lot of cheering, and ladies and girls, women would come up and ask for CDs. And I give out CDs for free. You know, I give them out. It's free. Oh, you're awesome, dude, and all that. It's really fun. And my wife, she handles. I've got a nice little case, chrome type case that I keep the CDs in. But I, in my excitement, left one of my huge powered speakers, and I left it in the garden. When we packed up, we thought we had everything, we left. And just to show you the bicycle community, the next day I suddenly realized I didn't have it and I didn't know where it was. I figured it was in the garden somewhere. And on Facebook, I contacted Bike Peoria Co-op, and they said, don't worry, we got it, we saw it, we figured you just forgot it, and we've got it in our shop and we're keeping it locked up for you, and you can come get it. I said, I'll be there tomorrow, it was Saturday. And I went in there and they, you know, they kept it and guarded it for me, and that was just really neat. I thanked them. They go, hey, we're all about community. And Chillicothe Historical Society and other organizations are all about community and keeping people aware of the roots. I was, you know, it kind of broke my heart. Somebody said something to me today, one of you wonderful people, that broke my heart. It really broke my heart. I heard that Zorro is practically unknown. Even the people that are 30, 40, 50, 60 years old. And I'm 64, I think, something like that. And I quit counting a long time ago. But I've heard of Zorro. I've seen the movies. Sometimes on cable, I can see the old reruns of Zorro. I love the TV series. I love it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm kind of shocked, because I know that Zorro was the first superhero. The characteristics of Zorro are now repeated in Spider-Man, Batman, Superman, Green Arrow, all the Transformers, all these guys that forget the names of them all now, the X-Men and things.
Who were some of the manufacturers of bikes in Peoria?
Rouse. I believe Duryea had manufacturing. It's in my book. And like I said, I wrote it in 1990, so it's a little fuzzy now. Rouse was one of the big ones. And yes?
I was wondering, did people take them to work a lot? Because they didn't take up much space in a parking lot, like if you worked for Hiram Walker or, you know, anybody, where they had a large number of employees.
Because in the summer, in the good months.
I mean, you wouldn't take your horse, you know, I mean, that.
Well, maybe you did.
I don't know what to tell you about
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
I know I've done it. I've ridden a bicycle to work and back. I worked at Vanakken, it's called The Junction, I think it was Vanakken's restaurant up there in Peoria, and Northern Peoria, and I worked as a waiter many years ago, and I had a bicycle as a mountain bike, pretty sturdy, rugged bike, and I would get off around 11, but I had to do side work, they called it, and stuff, and check out, and the credit cards and all that. So sometimes I wouldn't leave the restaurant in the Knockins Junction until maybe 12 or 1 o'clock in the morning, and I go whizzing down Knoxville with very little shoulder and some lights and some reflectors, but a very dangerous, risky thing. And I'm talking about these guys on their big wheel bicycles. Yeah, I did something kind of risky going down Knoxville late at night. Yeah.
What kind of racing did they, was it just track racing or did they do road racing too?
It was track racing. They had a big racing track. Yeah.
You know what the surface was? Was it all dirt?
It was hard dirt, I think, at the time.
We got a picture over there. It shows something, right? Yeah.
Along the lines of the traffic, have you investigated much the and thought maybe about ways that bikes and cars can currently work together more constructively?
So I'm glad you brought that up. That's an excellent question, and it's a huge topic for me because I walk a lot. I had a pretty clean driving record until a few years ago, and then I got in two wrecks within 2 months. And the second one, I totaled my car. And I told my wife, I'm not driving anymore. And then I found out I had cataract surgery, but there was scar tissue forming over the eyes. And so a bus came out of nowhere, you know, and I started to cross the road and slammed into the side of the city bus. But it worked out okay. We got a much nicer car. We got way more than the car was worth from the insurance company. So it's actually kind of a good thing in a way that frightened me. And I thought, I'm just not going to drive until I know my eyes are perfect and all that. And so I take a bus or a cab, or mostly I walk. And I'll walk, you know, 2 hours, you know, one way if I need to.
He does walk.
But yeah, I walk all over the place. And I take my camera and make it more interesting because I think walking is boring. But if I had my camera, I could take photos and stuff. And I have a page called We Are Peoria on Facebook, and also Peoria Art and Music Society, where I try to document and encourage and support music and art and just Peoria in general. We Are Peoria. But you bring this up. One thing that I don't like is when I'm walking down a sidewalk and all of a sudden somebody whizzes past me on the sidewalk, no bell, no buzzer, no, coming up behind you. I worked in restaurants, and when you had a hot plate tray of food, you'd say, hot food coming through, and people just kind of get out of your way. But these guys on bicycles, now I sympathize because I had a guy do that, come whizzing past me real fast, and sometimes I'll just suddenly jaywalk. Because jaywalking in police, I saw a show on TV, police said it's safer to jaywalk than to cross at an intersection, especially now with texting. Now, legally, you're supposed to cross at the crosswalks, but a police officer on a TV show said you're actually safer jaywalking because, and now with texting and people on their cell phones and stuff, a lot of times they're not paying attention, and when the light turns green, they may be on their phone, then they look up and go, and you can be in front of them. You haven't gotten quite past them yet. Anyway, so sometimes I'll suddenly cross the street, and when the guy's whizzing past me on the bicycle on the sidewalk, I could easily, you know, knock into him, knock him into traffic. We could both get killed.
Sure.
And I don't mean to make a big deal because what they say to me is, and sometimes I'll see him, I say, get on the street, not get off the sidewalk. And I think it's a law that you're in Peoria that you're supposed to ride a bicycle on the street.
Yeah.
It's a flow of traffic. I think it's a law. Yeah. But they will say, well, there's so much texting and people on cell phones, I don't feel safe on the street. I feel safer on the sidewalk. Well, the compromise is, well, at least can you ring a bell or a buzzer or yell at me? Coming up behind you.
That's required. That's,
yeah. Oh, it is required now.
Bell or horn.
Yeah. I never see them. I never hear them. Ever.
Used to the 5 I could have.
Yeah. Yeah, I have the little ringers and stuff. Mm-hmm. At least the motorized ones, I can hear them. Yeah. Yes.
Now, we just got back from Washington, D.C., and Washington, D.C., downtown, they have bike lanes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. They have a parking lane, mm-hmm. and you have a bike lane, and you have one lane going this lane, another lane.
We have a few of those in Peoria, not very many, up by Bradley, a few other, mm-hmm. Peoria Heights, I think, maybe.
Monroe.
That's a good solution there, bike lanes.
Some people, it was in the paper recently, Peoria just got rental bicycles racks around town. There's six rental bike racks, mm-hmm. and they're much better bikes. I've rented bikes in other cities, and these bikes are way better.
Than oh, really? Good. Bikes. I just heard about that.
They're very decent bikes, and they're scattered around town, the different racks are. Mm-hmm. So
$25 a year. And you can, or it's $25 a year, and you can use the bike anywhere you're
at. The first hour is free when you do the annual membership, after the first hour is $3 an hour.
Yeah, and then there's the segues, but those are mainly just to go along. You know, I guess the segue was the biggest marketing failure in recent times. People thought that everybody wanted to get on these gyroscopic type contraptions and go around, not walk anymore and stuff, but I guess
the guy
it just didn't work out.
Just died.
Yeah.
Doing a selfie.
Really?
In regard to the right comment about racing on the road or not, I've done a lot of research in our newspapers from 1883 on, and there are numerous comments and articles about the guys who would have in their club like group, they would race from Chillicothe to downtown at the courthouse in Peoria on Saturday night, and they'd meet the Peoria guys to race, and they would race back before it got dark. So that they then meet and have beer. They used to do that on a regular thing.
Chicken run. They called it a chicken run.
Yeah.
They'd meet and have chicken. I forget that. I got that in my book, even a photo of the invitation card and the restaurant, but they called them chicken runs. Chillicothe and Peoria were very closely united in bicycle, the early bicycle days.
Was it because we had the only decent road out of Peoria? I mean,
it was a chicken restaurant.
But I mean, you know, compared to going to the city or something.
I did find, and I've always found it very interesting, is that a bicyclist was southbound on 2nd Street down by City Hall, and there was a young lady on her bicycle northbound at City Hall. They somehow found each other and crashed and went into the ditch.
Wow.
She got knocked unconscious. He broke a leg, and he was goofy. And they were in the place where the current police department is today. That was the location. So here we have no traffic signs, no car cross traffic, and they find themselves crashing on two bicycles.
And that was before cell phones.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, or texting.
Yeah, not texting.
It probably weren't right.
I'll tell you, I'm not a big fan of driverless cars. I don't know how you guys feel. I don't like, for one thing, the government is becoming more of a surveillance state, and maybe it's for terrorism, or maybe not. I don't know. I'm not a big fan of that, although I know we have to, you know, protect ourselves from terrorism. But when there's so much surveillance going on, and yet a lot of these terrorists bypass the surveillance somehow, and they weren't on the radar or whatever. But if you have cars that can be controlled, the government can kind of decide, or not just not the government, but whoever gets control can decide where you're going to go and where you're not going to go. I don't mean to be paranoid, but
yeah,
I don't want to get an idea. Cars
that
drive themselves, and they're not safer. And the big controversy is, if you're in a driverless car and the car's got an algorithm that decides what to do in an emergency, there's going to be a point where the car will decide, do I save the motorist, the driver, or do I save the other guy?
Correct.
Life. That's a dilemma that's
or itself.
And there's also, you know, we hear, I went to the driver's license bureau. I had to take it after a couple crack wrecks that were my eye problem. I had to take a class in safe driving. And the question came up, well, if so much trouble is caused by texting and using cell phones when driving a car, can't something be done that would disable the cell phone when you're in the car, that the person in the driver's seat, maybe some kind of field or something, technology that would disable his phone? Other passengers could be on a phone, because that's no problem. But the driver, it would disable the phone or disable the car. That if your cell phone's on, your car won't start. Something like that. And they said, yes, the technology's there, but the telecommunication companies don't want it. They'd make less money. The telecommunication companies, according to the DMV, they don't really care if you die when you're texting and driving. They want that money from the cell phone plans.
That's
what they told me in the DMV. So,
yes. In regard to the driverless cars, the thing that boggles my mind is, we right now, on an average car, have over 30 computers in the car.
Yeah.
And controlling all sorts of facets of the vehicle. Now, when you have a driverless car, it's got to have way more computers.
and it's sending out signals all the time on every direction. So now you get 30 of those cars all sending out signals. How are you going to keep them all straight? That this car is going to crash into that car or not? You know, how do they recognize and determine which ones are going to be avoidable? I don't know how they're going to be able to have a CPU that's going to be so good. I mean, it's going to be unbelievable in its power.
Well, didn't one of the people that invented one of them die when the technology misread the blinding sunlight outside the semi and thought it wasn't there?
Could be.
Or hackers. You got an enemy. They're going to hack you. They might hack your car into your car to steal your car or to kill you.
Did you see that demonstration on 60 Minutes a couple years ago where they demonstrated a Chevy Malibu, and they had it in this arena, and the guy was driving. One of the guys was just driving normally. They had a hacker that hacked the code to control the brakes and the accelerator, and the guy that just took over, this guy was running him on the keyboard inside the building, and this guy couldn't do anything in the car. It went whatever the guy had the keyboard told him to go.
Yeah. If driverless cars become more popular, I'd be happy to preach a sermon against them.
That's me.
On the media, kind of get back to it.
Did you?
He wants to copy.
Okay.
I had a couple of comments about your book. One of them is you dedicate a full page to Major Taylor's poem.
Yes.
He was very famous, probably the world's top writer, racer at the time.
Yes,
he proved himself in Peoria, I think, at the early age of 16, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I think he came from Indianapolis, but had to come to Peoria. And he was African-American, and there was a lot of prejudice against him.
Yes.
And some people refused to ride with him, all that kind of stuff, you know.
That's right, and I mentioned that in my book about it was a racial victory for racial relations. And this is that poem, it's called A Tribute to My Silent Steed. And this isn't him, but this is a typical race guy in the outfit and so forth. But yes, that was quite interesting.
I do some rides in Chicago. And there's Chicago has a Major Taylor bicycle club.
Oh, wow. Oh,
really?
It's a large club.
Explain to us the definition of the safety bicycle as opposed to any other kind of bicycle that you've been mentioning.
Well, it was basically the configuration of the wheels and the brakes. I think those were the two main things. Because the gear system was pretty much the same. Somebody might clarify this even better. But I believe it was the reducing... and then better brakes, because the brakes were awful. They called it safety because it was so much safer, and there was a good way to describe safety bicycles. Some people were afraid of them. They'd see people, you know, take headers, go flying headlong, and they go, that's not for me. So they had to think of something, because after the fad and the frenzy wore down, they had to think of something that your average non-risk-taking person would be more comfortable with.
When did the tube come in?
Again, that's in my book. That came in pretty quickly, about the same time the safety bicycle. The high wheel were called ordinaries. Right? Funny. It's not very ordinary to me. It's in the book, that exact date.
I've got three old refrigerators now. I want that three-wheeled looking thing that Lincoln was in, and I'll put on a motor.
Yeah.
I got to find one of those.
Well, thanks a lot for having me. It's a delightful seeing you. Tell you something that's is kind of naughty. I shouldn't say this, but I sometimes get a kick out of Peoria because people that live in Chicago sometimes think they're superior to people who live in Peoria, and the people who live in Peoria sometimes they think they're superior to people who live in Creve Coeur or Tillamook or Pekin or whatever. So when I see Peoria is real, I call it all boondoggle city. We have so many boondoggles, wasted tax money and stupid projects. It's nonstop. Now the city council wants to buy the water company, and we're like, oh my God, they can't manage themselves out of a paper bag. terrible corruption. And here's the naughty thing I say. Thank you for hearing me say it. I say, it's funny, Peoria wants to be a little Chicago, but they can't even figure out how to be a big Chillicothe. Shame on me for saying something. No offense to Chillicothe either. I'm kind of praising.
How soon are you going to have to move here?
Hey, I like this area. I like this. I like you people. This is impressive. This historical society facility is amazing.
Did you guys get here too late?
Had a hard time finding it.
Oh. Well, you get a free book.
Are you
going to go get
someone else's? I'd like to.